Cotabato City Mayor Cynthia Gayani Sayadi blasts the proposal to extend the transition period for the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARMM, until 2025. She says adding 3 more years will not change anything because the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, the region's interim government, does not listen to the concerns of the public anyway. Joining us now is Attorney Naguib Sinarimbo. He's a local government, is the Minister of the Local Government and the Interior, and the spokesman of BARMM. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, sir. Good morning po sa mga kababayan natin. Maganda umaga po sa lahat.
Okay, first, let's talk about this attack last night in Datupiang. Have you identified specifically which group or faction of the BIFF was behind this?
From the reports we are receiving from the Armed Forces of the Philippines and the Philippine National Police, it's the BIFF in the SPMS box that was responsible for the attack in the military detachment and the police station in Datupiang po last night.
And would you know what the intention was? Of course, it was an attack, but perhaps what was the message the group was trying to send, especially given the timing of the attack?
Yung pong nasa SPMS box na BIFF, pakonti ng pakonti ho yan, but they continue to do harassments to check na meron pang strength yung BIFF dyan. But in reality, madami na ho ang lumalabas sa kanila. In fact, under my ministry, yung Project Togon, which is a response to the BIFF na mga lumalabas, nagjo-join ng government, meron na tayong 150 dyan na individuals, including their commanders na nag-undergo ng livelihood development program under the ministry po.
Okay. Now, this morning, I was in touch with Mayor Gayani regarding this particular attack. And from her perspective, and I think this is also shared by some of her supporters, that attack could also be seen as an indication that perhaps the BTA is not yet fully in control in terms of securing the new autonomous region. How do you respond to that?
Matagal ho yung process nung pag-secure talaga ng peace. If you remember, yung BIFF was a splinter group from the original MILF. Nung nagkaroon ng hindi pagkakasundo yung government doon sa signing ng comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro, earlier, ito yung MOA AD, nagkaroon ng serious na split. Itong BIFF under kay Umrakato, formerly 105 Base Command ng MILF, hindi na sila nag-agree na may value pa yung peace negotiations with the government dahil hindi naman daw po tumutupad ang gobyerno. So ang naging option nila ay makipaglaban ng makipaglaban. So hanggang ngayon ay tinatry nating i-win over yung mga grupo na ito na maliliit na bumalik na sila sa mainstream na organization para ho ma-test run natin yung autonomy na nakuha natin. If it works, and we should all make it work, dapat ho matigil na yung mga paglalaban. So ito yung challenge natin sa ngayon.
And so far, do you think you are succeeding somehow in your effort to win them over?
So far, okay naman po yung result. In fact, meron tayong ongoing na pag-uusap sa kanila. And this was sinabi ho namin kay Pangulo at kay Secretary Lorenzana ng DND na may ongoing na pag-uusap doon sa isang major na component ng BIFF at potentially ay babalik sila. Inaayos na lang ho natin yan. In the coming months, I think makikita natin yung result niyan.
Which particular group are you talking about within the BIFF?
Yung kay kila Bungos po, kausap po natin yan. Except yung ISIS talaga, yeah. Yung kila Toraypi, hindi ho natin yung kinakausap.
Yeah, and of course, have you basically accepted the fact that the Abu Toraypi faction or group won't be participating or joining, or you won't be winning over that group anymore?
Meron na hong initial na usapan noon sa kanila, very low level, just to send a message na we have a new government in the Bangsamoro and that perhaps it is time for all of us to come together and then try to make this government work. Hindi ho yung nag-succeed. And then ultimately, nag-plead sila ng allegiance sa ISIS. So from that point on, hindi na ho talaga natin kinakausap.
Okay. Now, given the persistent threat, security threat in the Bangsamoro, how much pressure is on the shoulders now of the BTA to show results, concrete results, at least until 2022, in case the extension is not granted?
From the very beginning naman po, alam ho natin yung ano yung major challenges na kinoconfront ng MILF in the transition and in the implementation of the peace agreements. Isa rito yung internal na problem noon na nagkaroon ng split. Alam ho natin na maski maliit na grupo yan, kaya pa rin manggulo. Pangalawa ho would be the resistance from the establishment. Ito ho yung mga traditional politicians who always opposed any major radical change in the political landscape of the region. May mga well-entrenched na interest dyan. So often, ito ho ay ini-express and couch in a different language. But essentially, these are still reactionary forces in the Moro society who always enjoyed the status quo. So pag na-threaten yung status quo, nagre-react sila. So alam po natin yung challenges na yun. But essentially, ang talagang gusto nating ma-achieve is a transformation in the lives of the Bangsamoro. Yun ho ang pinakauna sa atin dahil ang talaga naman pong ipinaglaban ay una yung kapayapaan and then yung development that goes down into the level of the individuals, not for politicians, not for those who hold political interest in the region.
Yeah, of course, we know that a lot is at stake here in this peace process in the Bangsamoro. But of course, people are expecting tangible results despite the tight schedule that you have now. Now, do you really need a 3-year extension for the transition to be completed?
May consensus between the national government and the Bangsamoro government, the government of the day, as well as the peace panels in the government. So yung government at saka yung MILF, na hindi matatapos yung essential work in the transition, in the remaining period ngayon sa government, which is up to 2022. Over a year na lang po yung natitira. So like, on the part of the national government, yung lahat ng deliverables nila, obligations nila, from their internal assessment, coming from Secretary Galvez himself, who heads the OPAP and whose office handles the peace panel of government, merong pagtanggap sa kanila na hindi nila matatapos. Let me cite a few of ano yung hindi kayang i-deliver ng government in the remaining period. Una, yung transfer ng national agencies at saka yung powers of the national agencies operating in the region. So, alimbawa, engineering district of DPWH in Cotabato City, under the organic law, 3 months after na ma-institute yung Bangsamoro government, dapat nalipat na yan. Hindi rin po na-delineate yung Bangsamoro waters para ma-exercise ng Bangsamoro government yung regulatory powers niya over the territory in the Sulu Sea and in the Moro Gulf. Hindi rin na-delineate and consequently, hindi na pagkasunduan yung share ng national government noon sa zones of joint cooperation in the Moro Gulf and in the Sulu Sea. So you have oil exploration, for instance, in the Sulu Sea that would fall under the zones of joint cooperation. Pag hindi na fixed yung sharing percentage dyan, hindi ho makakakuha ng share na yung Bangsamoro government. Ano hindi reason? Pa rin ho natatransfer yung...
Pero bakit hindi naayos yan at this stage?
Dahil, una, bago lang ho tinatag yung gobyerno last year, sometime March, and then pumasok tayo, ang major task last year was one to phase out the bureaucracy of the ARMM, which is mandated by law. And at the same time, phase in gradually a new bureaucracy. So ito yung institution building part. But the whole gamut of institution building, ito ho ay bilateral. Hindi ho kaya na yung Bangsamoro government lang ang mag-deliver nito. Yung national government will have to part with some of the powers, offices, properties and programs that it currently holds, ilipat niya ho ito sa Bangsamoro government. Ito yung tinitake up natin sa intergovernmental relations body.
Yun nga, so, sir, I was supposed to ask that. Is that actually working now? Because that is one of the most important components in this peace process.
Tama po yun. Nag-work naman siya, but Christian, ito ho ay bilateral. So maski na gusto namin i-comply yung period within which government should transfer these powers, these offices, and these programs, hindi naman po ganun kabilis ang galaw sa government. So halimbawa, yung watershed surrounding Lake Lanao, under the organic law, within 3 months yan, dapat nalipat na. Until today, over a year, hindi pa ho nalilipat sa amin. So marami ho yung obligations pa ng national government na from their assessment, hindi kakayanin kaagad. The bureaucracy moves in a way na hindi kasing bilis nung desire natin. So ito ho yung mga practical considerations. Hindi pa ho natin sinasali dyan yung discussion doon sa
normalization
track. Yes.
Now, given this this experience over more than a year already, more than halfway through the 3-year transition, did you also get the sense that somehow the national government has lost focus, if not priority, in dealing with the Bangsamoro? Perhaps distracted because of other issues like the pandemic?
Yung COVID ho, admittedly, has distracted national government and for that matter, the whole world. Hindi naman po peculiar lang yan sa national government. Pati sa atin ho, medyo na disturb yung focus natin doon sa pagpapatibay ng institusyon ng autonomiya sa Bangsamoro government. And then yung pangalawa, yung paglalatag ng mga programa na mararamdaman ng mga kababayan natin sa baba. So ito ho yung major components ng transition na ngayon ay nahihirapan tayo dahil sa COVID. But it's not just COVID. Medyo complex ho talaga yung transition.
Yeah, we understand that. Number one, yung budget, di ba? There was a time for the first several months you were operating using the budget of the ARM. But of course, hindi naman ganun kaliit din yung budget na yon. But it took time before you actually enjoyed the benefits, before the benefits under the BOL started trickling down. So we understand the complications. But I'd like you to react to this because yesterday we had Mayor Cynthia Gayani, the mayor of Cotabato City. We know her position against inclusion in BARMM despite the vote of her city during the plebiscite last year to be included under BARMM. Pero sabi niya, why not just push through with the elections in 2022 para magkaalaman na?
Often, yung pong issue of legitimacy is equated with elections. But that is never the case. In many peace and conflict issue, yung pong election was never the measure for legitimacy. Often, when you deal with organizations and movements that asserts yung right to self-determination, hindi ho minimeasure yon through elections. Like for instance, why was government willing to go for a transition government and did not go from the very beginning for an election? Alam naman po natin na hindi yun ang measure ng legitimacy. The measure for legitimacy has always been the validity of the cause of the Bangsamoro. And that is universally accepted, hindi lang dito sa atin. Now, the basic question is, would the peace agreement be sustained if we go for an election in 2022? Yung po ba ay masusustain? Yung po bang elections in the past, in the local government units for over a century now in the country, has it really resolved the basic conflict in Mindanao and the assertion of the Bangsamoro for the right to self-determination? Maraming elections na ho ang nangyari, pero hindi pa rin ho nare-resolve nung elections na yon yung issue nung Bangsamoro. So why would we distract ourselves to the petty elections of local officials in the country and in the Bangsamoro and sacrifice the overall goal of achieving peace and development in the region? If you remember, Christian, ang major peace agreement na nangyari in this decade ay yung sa atin lang, yung Comprehensive Agreement on the Bangsamoro, signed in 2014.
Yeah.
Ang pinaka-early na sinundan natin na peace agreement was the agreement in Nepal, signed in 2006. So globally, yung mundo is looking at the Bangsamoro peace process with keen interest. Kasi pwede yung maging model siya for resolving a lot of conflict. Ito ho yung big picture na gusto nating makita ng mga kababayan natin. If we endanger yung success ng peace agreement in exchange for petty political interest in the region, which has always been there for a long time and has never resolved the conflict in the south, masasayang ho yung peace agreement na pinaghirapan natin.
Okay, we understand that big picture perspective, but do you think the MILF, being at the helm of the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, still enjoys wide support from the people, given its track record over the past year or so?
Kampante naman po tayo na suportado pa ho ng mga kababayan natin yung Moro Islamic Liberation Front and the cause that it is advocating. In fact, yung mga local government units na opposed to it ay mabibilang mo lang. So like Sulu, na from the very beginning was against it, Cotabato City, the mayor herself, who has always opposed the peace agreement and the inclusion of Cotabato City. But yung mga tao naman talaga ang ultimate na dapat pinapakinggan natin. So for Cotabato City, in the last plebiscite, 36,682 ang nag-yes. Ang nag-no-ho ay 24,000 lang. Ang provision ng batas at saka ng saligang batas ng constitution, yung pong mga tao ang magde-decide dun sa inclusion nila. Hindi po ang mayor, hindi po ang governor. So when the people said in the plebiscite, yung turnout natin sa BARMM last plebiscite, yung 2.8 million na voters natin, 1.7 ang lumabas at bumoto. Of the 1.7, 1.5 said yes to the institution of a new autonomous government in the region. So overwhelming pa rin ho yan. Okay. Nasa 90% yan ng mga botante natin. But of course, if you ask yung mga oppositors from the very beginning, magsasabi ho na hindi yan.
Okay, but we know that there's still a pending case filed by Mayor Giani before the Supreme Court questioning the very legitimacy of that plebiscite last year in her city. Because there were reports not only coming from her that some of incidents that involve violence or pressure or harassment of certain residents to support the inclusion of Cotabato City. But of course, this issue still needs to be settled by the Supreme Court. In the meantime, what do you intend to do with Cotabato City? Because legally, Cotabato City is already included in the BARMM. And I understand there was an agreement before the Office of the President with President Duterte to finish this issue by this month, meaning December, ngayon. So can you do that? Or are you willing to give, for instance, Cotabato City more time not to be actually placed under the BARMM, since you yourself is pushing for a 3-year extension?
Yung pong decision sa inclusion at yung turnover ng Cotabato City, yung inclusion ho tinapos nung plebiscite yon.
Yeah, legally.
Legally. Yung pong pag-turnover is a matter between the national government under the peace agreement and the organic law and the Bangsamoro government. As for the national government, obligation ho nila yon under the organic law na i-turn over nila yung supervision over the city within a period of 6 months. Lagpas na ho tayo yon. Kaya po nagkaroon ng meeting last year, September, sa Malacanang. Nandoon ho si Pangulo, nandoon si Mayor ng City, nandoon ho kami. It was the city mayor who asked in that meeting that they be given until December of this year, para daw po matapos na lang nila yung mga proyekto na under the national government. And so when the IGRB met, nag-meeting ho si Secretary Dominguez at saka si Minister Iqbal, kasama ho kami doon sa Intergovernmental Relations Body, ang naging decision ng IGRB, lalo na si Secretary Dominguez, is to comply with the commitment made in the September meeting in Malacañang, which is to turn over Cotabato City this December. So kaya po nung 27 October na meeting ng IGRB, nag-decide na ho talaga yung IGRB na i-turn over. I understand the mayor appealed to the president. The president has denied the appeal last October 19 na hindi na ho natin mapatagal pa yung pag-turnover sa Cotabato City dahil nasa batas po yan. Wala na po, naman pong temporary restraining order from the Supreme Court. In fact, wala rin ho kaming na-receive na notice from the Supreme Court na mayroong pending case na final yung Cotabato City. So, what we've received is a notice doon sa case na final ng Sulu provincial
sa
government.
Yes, and we, sa Kortan. Questioning opo, the BOL naman.
Yes, at nasagot na ho yun, nasa Supreme Court na ho yan. But Cotabato City, wala ho kaming nare-receive na notice.
So will the turnover happen this month?
Opo, kahapon po, nag-meet, pursuant to the agreement in the IGRB at yung earlier meeting namin ni Secretary Anyo, nag-meet yung technical working group namin kahapon at nag-agree, nagkasundo na doon sa program for the turnover this December 15 po.
Okay, now you're pushing for a 3-year extension, so from 2022 until 2025. Now for context, originally the transition was envisioned to be 6 years, right? So,
yes.
Umikli talaga siya ng 3 years. So, understandably, you would want to push for 3 more years as originally proposed several years ago. But in this case, Can you actually finish the job if you're given another 3 years? Because you have other important elements. You have at least 5 or 4 more codes that you need to pass. I'm talking about the Bangsamoro Parliament. And of course, You need to finish the job in terms of normalization. The decommissioning of around 40,000 MILF combatants.
Tama po yun. If you look at the outline, the roadmap in the peace agreement, and which is part of that contained in the organic law, yung period really, ideally, would be 6 years. And which is why, nung negotiations in Kuala Lumpur, and in the push for the BOL, talagang ang nasa proposal ng MILF is to go for a 6-year transition period. Dahil ina-anticipate na namin yung delay in the transfer of national powers na binigay sa Bangsamoro government. Because ang actual experience natin sa ARM, yung transfer of powers, yung devolution issue in the original organic law, dapat matatapos yun in a period of 6 months din.
But
in the last 29 years na existence ng ARM, hindi natapos yung devolution. And which is why we have a new design for transfer of powers in the organic law. In-enumerate na siya in the organic law. So inisa-isa ano yung powers. And then we created a body, which is the IGRB, para doon pag-usapan. Dahil ang experience natin sa ARM, pag hinayaan na individual departments and their counterparts in the defunct ARMM ang mag-usap, tumatagal ho yan, lalo na pag nagbabago-bago yung secretary ng department. Yeah. So merong permanent na structure for dealing with the transfer of powers and the transition. From our assessment, matatapos ho yan in the next 3 years. And because the normalization is linked to political milestones, ibig sabihin yung development in the Bangsamoro government, yung normalization susundan niya yung pacing ng political transition natin. So like in the annex on normalization, if government manages to have the organic law ratified, we will decommission 30% of our combatants.
Yeah, yeah, we understand.
Happened.
That.
Oh, okay. So yan na po yung 12,000. The second political milestone is that when we operationalize the Bangsamoro Police in the Bangsamoro, we will decommission 35%. Yan ho ay pinag-uusapan na sa ngayon. May list na tayo ng 14,000 na i-decommission. Ang next phase niyan ay when we do the assessment prior to the exit agreement, the TPMT and the panels, magre-report sila doon sa accomplishment ng parties in the agreement kung na-comply ba ng government yung lahat ng obligation niya, na-comply ba ng MILF yung lahat ng obligation niya. Pag nag-agree tayo doon, then we will go for an exit agreement. During that time, pag nagkasundo tayo, lahat na nung natitirang puwersa at baril ng MILF, i-decommission natin. So looking at this at this roadmap, you will understand kung bakit kailangan natin ng 3 years. And from the assessment, really, nung peace panel, even if you ask the third-party monitoring team, ito lang naman po yung talagang dalawang mechanisms, institutions in the peace architecture na merong karapatan na sumagawa ng review and assessment. Okay. Ito yung peace panels and the third-party monitoring team.
I'd like to go to the issue of amnesty. When should the President issue an amnesty proclamation?
Yung pong amnesty na yan ay kasama doon sa confidence-building measures ng government na kinumit nila, including yung transformation ng camps. Ideally, the CBM should happen early. Kaya ho sa amin, sa part namin, we already submitted the draft amnesty doon sa government para ho mailabas yun. Because meron din itong implication doon sa elections and candidacy.
That's
so if you are an MILF, you have a pending case, you've not been granted an amnesty, you will be disqualified from running into public office. Hindi ho po pwede na sumali ka sa election nang meron kang kaso. So, if it does not move and you push for an election in 2022, dine-deprive mo yung mga senior members of the MILF from participating in the political exercise.
How many
so, kasali
MILF,
ho yan sa problema natin.
How many MILF members or officials are we talking about here? Those who are supposed to be covered by the amnesty proclamation.
Medyo madami po yan, Christian.
More or less po, para may idea tayo.
Meron tayo yung roughly around 500. Na-submit na rin ho namin yung list sa government counterparts natin.
Okay. Now, another concern is this. I think this is also more of a challenge issued to you by your critics. Baka naman daw takot lang kayong matalo sa 2022. And I think this is also somehow acknowledged by Chairman Murad Ibrahim when I spoke to him more than 2 weeks ago. Kumbaga, he was concerned na baka isipin ng mga tao sa baba because they're not seeing most of the promised changes or reforms. Kasi nga, given the limited period of time during the 3-year transition, baka isipin wala naman daw ginawa yung MILF. So in this case, is that an actual fear? The fear of losing in 2022? That's why you're pushing for a 3-year extension?
Kaya naman po sigurong manalo ng election. Pero several factors that we need to consider. One, if we go for an election in 2022, obviously the MILF and the government of the day will have to refocus its attention into winning elections rather than institution building, instituting programs, making the changes necessary in the region. So the practical translation for that is that instead of pursuing programs that are supposed to make radical changes in the Bangsamoro, we will have to negotiate with politicians and political players in the region. Distracts the whole venture into transforming the Bangsamoro into a peaceful and developed region, into becoming a region where we play politics. So ayaw ho nating mangyari yun. Pangalawa, may endanger ho nung political exercise na yon, yung peace and security in the region. You can just imagine, and you know this, everyone knows, yung elections in the region, laging magulo. And this is the previous elections was conducted with regular politicians in the region participating into it. Pag hinalo mo pa yung Moro Islamic Liberation Front and its political party into the fray without changing yung rules of the game, lalo ho tayong magugulo.
Okay.
Yung pong electoral code for the Bangsamoro, which is now at the drafting stage sa committee, which hopefully will be enacted first quarter of next year in the parliament, complex po yung election process doon. So meron kang shift into parliamentary elections where you will have district representation, but also 50% of that will have to be elected through political party.
Yeah.
And then may isa ka pang component doon sa reserve seats for specific sectors na may iba rin ang rules for election.
Yeah,
so medyo complex po yung election.
Finally,
na
Attorney Sinarimbo, I'd like to ask about mindset here because we know that the MILF are long-time revolutionaries, rebel force, and we know that there's a lot of adjustment needed to serve as actual governors of a new regional government. I think the officials of MILF have been quite candid in acknowledging that struggle, that difficulty of adjustment. Now, in this case, how do you respond to those who are questioning the competence of the MILF so far in running the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, and also the concerns that somehow, despite the promised reforms to make political parties work, that in the Bangsamoro Parliament somehow it's still very much personalistic in terms of the approach to politics. Kumbaga hindi pa masyadong gumagana yung systems that are supposed to be in place. Na talagang ultimately it's still the MILF running the show, like it's still the old revolutionary group. How do you respond to that?
Meron talagang transition inside the MILF. So it's not just a transition from ARM to BARMM. It's also a transition for the MILF from revolutionary ARM group into one that now transitions into democratic processes and elections and governance. Acknowledge naman po yun. In terms of competency, meron namang very competent people inside the MILF. Meron din mga iba na yung set of competencies niya may not be for government. Ha? Hindi managerial yung skills, kundi running a war or undertaking guerrilla warfare. So, acknowledge naman po yun. In the process, syempre, pinag-aaralan din nila yung set of competencies at saan nilalagay yung mga tao. And this has been acknowledged in several meetings by the MILF. So alam naman po nila yon. Yung adjustments na yon, you're seeing it also. So like, some members of the BTA are not really members of the MILF, pero nominees ng MILF. Yeah. In the cabinet of the Bangsamoro government, it is also a mixed group. Hindi lang lahat MILF. So meron kami, nandiyan kami na mga lawyers, merong representation yung MNLF, merong representation yung Christian sector and the government national. So ito yung mix. In the hiring for the bureaucracy, we've been very, very open to people. In fact, inopen nga yung jobs portal ng Bangsamoro and we've received over 300,000 applications. Yung processing the over 300,000 na aplikante is also taking time. But we've set the standards for entry into the bureaucracy. Some of these policies have actually displaced some members of the MILF. But that's the reality of the transition into government. So nakikita naman po yun. Okay. Some of the issues na sinasabing contributory doon sa inefficiency ng Bangsamoro government, hindi lang ho naintindihan ng mga tao. Halimbawa, yung delay in the salaries for HRS, ito yung mga health workers. Ang problema talaga niyan, delay yung transfer from the national DOH pababa sa region.
Kaya hindi nakuha. Okay.
Problem naman po yan. Doon po okay. Sa mga provisionary teachers na sinasabing natanggal sila, matatanggal ho talaga dahil under the rules ng civil service, hindi pwedeng mag-appoint ng provisionary pag merong mga aplikante na kompleto yung qualification.
Okay.
So what the government has offered to them ay bigyan na lang muna kayo ng kontrata and then libre yung review nyo doon sa LET. Ito yung teachers board. Sasagutin ng region. We will issue a contract to you. If you pass the exam, then you can enter the DepEd in the region. Maging teacher okay. Naman po sila ulit.
Well, thank you very much for joining us, Attorney Naguib Sinarimbo, the Interior Minister, Interior and Local Government Minister of the Bangsamoro, and is also the spokesman. Thank you, sir.